Our last session, the third session, which is about looking ahead to the next decade of the Charter. And we will start with a keynote speech of President Poon Lennart. And I would like first to thank you very much, President Lennart, because I know that Tuesday is not a good day for the Court of Justice, but you have managed to come, and for us it was very important to have a keynote speech coming from you. So, President Lennart, I will ask you to take the floor.
So, dear colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, for many of you, it's a great honor and a pleasure for me to deliver this keynote speech, whatever that may mean in itself, at this important conference jointly organized by the European Commission, the Finnish Presidency of the Council of the European Union, and the EU Fundamental Rights Agency, in order to mark the 10th anniversary of the EU Charter of Fundamental Rights as a primary law source of EU law. Now, since the entry into force of the Lisbon Treaty, as we all know, the Charter has the same values as the treaties, which has increased considerably the visibility of fundamental rights, both within and outside the EU legal order. The Charter is, to quote my esteemed academic colleague and friend Daniel Sarmiento, a paramount reference of EU law that is at the forefront of European integration. As President of the Court, I couldn't agree more, and I hope to set that out during these 30 minutes. The binding character of the Charter complements the long-standing commitment on the part of the Court of Justice of the European Union to upholding fundamental rights as an integral part of the rule of law of the EU. Before the Charter became legally binding in 2009, fundamental rights were only occasionally examined by the Court of Justice. Nowadays, by contrast, the Charter is invoked in about 10% of all preliminary ruling procedures, which indicates not only a quantitative shift in the Court of Justice's case law, but also a qualitative change, going well beyond matters that concern the regulation of the internal market. And in a way, these 10%, one may clarify them rapidly as follows. The biggest share of these cases, 10% of 600 references, it's about 60 to 70 cases a year. Most of these cases, the biggest share, involve the Charter as a standard for interpretation of other rules of union law. That is, regulations, directives to be interpreted potius ut valiat, rather that they be valid, that is, in conformity with the Charter. More exceptionally, the Charter is invoked as a standard for outright judicial review when the legality of an act of the Union institutions is being challenged in whatever procedure. But, of course, it can then be in the preliminary rulings procedure, the validity control rubric of the preliminary rulings procedure. So that explains, as a tool of interpretation or as a standard for legality control, that the Charter is so heavily at the forefront of preliminary references. As a legally binding text of constitutional nature, the Charter has given rise to a series of seminal judgments that have placed the protection of fundamental rights at the core of the European legal order, and this in these last 10 years. Transforming the Charter into a source of primary EU law has increased the effective judicial protection of fundamental rights and given the Court of Justice the opportunity to resolve numerous questions that are of key importance for the Union's legal order. It is against that background that I want to examine with you, in fact, three aspects more specifically. First of all, I want to see how the Charter is applied, that is, the scope of application of the Charter, not only vis-à-vis the institutions and bodies of the Union, but also vis-à-vis the Member States and possibly even vis-à-vis private parties. So I will do that in a few steps. The scope of application of the Charter first, then the question whether the Charter is now uniformizing completely the fundamental rights protection, or whether the Charter, coexisting with national standards of fundamental rights protection, still leaves room for diversity in this area. And finally, aspects of horizontal application of some of the provisions of the Charter. Now, if there is some overlap with aspects others have touched upon during this day, then I beg for apology, but I had hearings this morning and could not leave Luxembourg before 2 p.m., which I did not do, but of course I may have missed out on some of the points. So, as you know, the interpretation and application of the Charter must comply with the principle of conferral. The Charter as such is not increasing or changing even the competences or the powers of the European Union. It also means that when Charter rights correspond to treaty rights, then the Charter right is to be understood like the treaty right. And it's extremely important, if you want to have an example of that, you can take the Delvigne case of 2015, 6th of October 2015, on the right to be a voter for the European Parliament elections. There you see the link between the citizenship rights and the Charter right, in that case Article 39 of the Charter. Vis-à-vis the Member States, as you all know, the provisions of the Charter are addressed to the Member States only when they are implementing Union law. And the word only is in other languages even a bit stronger. It's not just only, only is also restrictive, but it is ausschließlich, uniquement, uitsluitend for the Dutch speakers like myself. Uitsluitend. It's really a very, very strong indication which aims at a limitative effect. And that is, in a way, to demarcate the scope of application of the Charter as a common standard for fundamental rights in the European Union and in the Member States of the Union when they are implementing Union law, as opposed to the national constitutional standards protecting fundamental rights, possibly protecting them also in a more generous way at national level. So the question then is, what is this notion implementing Union law? I've said in earlier analysis of this subject that the Charter is the shadow of EU law, meaning in essence that there can be no situation that is governed by EU law in which the Charter does not apply. So whenever EU law, substantively speaking, applies, the Charter applies. So there cannot be a gap in applicability of the Charter whenever the Member States apply substantive EU law. To turn that positively, it is in a way necessary to indicate a provision or a principle of substantive EU law other than a Charter provision before the Charter becomes applicable in the context of national law. So let's now go a little bit more deeply or closely into the matter of what it means implementing EU law. The classical situations are the famous agency situation and the derogation situation. Examples: whenever member states are implementing specific obligations weighing on them or incumbent on them from Union law, like transposing a directive, but also executing a European arrest warrant. It's the judicial authority of the executing member state which is implementing the European arrest warrant issued by the judicial authority of the issuing member state. In all these situations, in the broadest way defined, member states are positively and actively, through decisions, legislative, executive, or judicial, implementing union law. That is the agency situation. It's on that score that in the famous Åkerberg-Franzen case of Grand Chamber 2013, the Court of Justice of the European Union held that the institution of criminal proceedings against a person for breaches of the obligation to declare value anatax fell within the scope of implementing union law, because member states are to provide for effective, proportionate and dissuasive sanctions. Those are the words used in the VAT directive. Implementing that at legislative level, at executive level, but also at judicial level through the conduct of criminal proceedings, all of that together encompasses implementation of union law and hence triggers the applicability of the Charter. In that case, it was the ne bis in idem issue which in that way came into our docket under Article 50 of the Charter and not under any other provision. The second situation is the famous derogation situation, and here I put some emphasis on it. Our case law was initially a little bit under stress, so to speak, precisely because of that restrictive wording. It is case law of the Court of Justice since decades before the existence of the Charter that whenever a member state derogates from a principle of union law, availing itself of a derogation clause in the substantive law of the Union or under case law of the Court of Justice, that of course while you derogate from an obligation, you can't do it in a way that breaches fundamental rights, because then accepting this derogation under a derogation clause or a derogatory jurisprudence of our court would indirectly validate a breach of fundamental rights. So that is the rationale behind this case law, saying when you derogate, it must be in conformity with the fundamental rights protected at EU level. Now, an argument was made in academia, in some member states more than in others, to be totally frank with you, where they said, ausschließlich, uniquement, uitsluitend. So it's very restrictive. And some read this as saying, now the applicability of the Charter can only be maintained in this first situation, agency, where you have some sort, legislative, executive, or judicial, fair enough, but positive action of implementation. To implement is to do something, and not simply to derogate, not to apply something. So that was the way it was presented. The court absolutely cut short to that, and it did it in several cases, but I quote only one case, the Aghet Iraklis case. It's maybe the most visible case, where the court held that when national legislation is justified on the basis of one imperative need to protect the public interest and thereby it is derogating from the freedom of establishment, that was the problem in that case, then the court will see whether the national rule derogating from the freedom of establishment is in this case in conformity with the social fundamental rights protected in the Charter or with other fundamental rights protected in the Charter. In other words, the implementing of union law is seen as a broad concept because in a way, even derogating, you are positively implementing something because you take a derogation clause which is in the treaties, that is the exceptions which you can apply to the free movement principles, for instance, for ordre public, national security, or for whatever, public health, for whatever reason, or some further reasons which have been recognized in the case law of the Court of Justice since the Cassis de Dijon case law, the imperative needs, the mandatory requirements of the general interest. So if you avail yourself of that, in a way, by your derogatory national rule, you're also implementing the exception allowed by union law. And that has been the construct to accept that this is also qualifying under Article 51, first paragraph of the Charter. But there are cases where it is extremely difficult, even with the wildest imagination, to bring this under this dichotomy of agency or derogation situation. So positive implementation or derogation implementation. And therefore, the court has given further instructions, so to speak, to national courts to gauge that situation, and it's not fully ended. We have now a case, for instance, relating to the working time. It's a Finnish case. The judgment will be delivered very soon now. And it's a case where the working time directive, which implements Article 31, second paragraph of the Charter, is in issue. And everyone agrees, of course, that to the extent that it is the implementation of the directive, this is very easy, it's agency, it is positive implementation, it's 51.1. Yes, but the Finnish, much to the protection of the workers, have granted more than just 4 weeks guaranteed by union law. And they give 5 weeks or 6 weeks, it depends a little bit from the seniority and from the sector of the economy involved, etc. So national law goes further. A directive says that the directive is a minimum and that national authorities beyond the minimum can do what they like if it's more protective. So they can't undercut the uniform level of social protection of the workers, but they can do more. And then the question is, in doing more, does that still fall under the Charter? For instance, I'm now hypothesizing, that's not a real case, but to fix easily our thoughts here in this room, if they were to say that women get 6 weeks and men get 5 weeks, yeah, then they would, of course, bump into another rule of union law, equal treatment. So that would then again qualify, but not because of the working time directive, but because of other rules of union law which offer you the substantive law nexus. But what when they say strictly within, and that's the real case, within the working time legislation, that if you fall sick during the 4 weeks, then you can recuperate the days of annual leave which you missed out. That's our case law. It's Schultz, Hoff, and KHS, etc. And they say we apply that, but only for the 4 weeks. For the additional fifth and sixth week, if you fall ill, it's to your risk. Because after all, union law does not even oblige us to give you a fifth and a sixth week. Is that case law, Schultz, Hoff, applicable for the fifth and the sixth week? Or is that purely national law? You will read the answer very soon. But it shows you that although it is rather easy to speak about this and to explain this in plain language here in an audience like this one, there continue to be cases before the Grand Chamber of the Court and where there is quite a bit of opposition, frankly speaking, between the parties taking part in such proceedings and also of possible different approaches between AGs, Advocates General, and the bench of the judges deciding the case. And that's quite normal. So this is a rather clear line in principle, but like often the application is more difficult. So the court tried in the EIDA case of November 2012, I was then chamber president, it was a case of my chamber at the time, five judges, the court said, to give it sort of a fuller set of criteria to judge on this substantive nexus with union law, so the court said it must be ascertained, among other things, so the list is not exhaustive, whether national legislation at issue is intended to implement the provision of EU law, what the character of that legislation is, and whether it pursues objectives other than those covered by EU law, even if it is capable of indirectly affecting that law, and also whether there are specific rules of EU law on the matter or capable of affecting it. So you see, this is an attempt to give somewhat more flesh on the bones of assessing whether there is or is not implementation of EU law. I think it is fair to say that when it all boils down to a single line, you have to ask yourself, does this case imply for the legislator, the executive, or the judiciary of the member state concerned to implement specific and concrete obligations incumbent upon them, flowing from union law, other, of course, than the Charter itself, set at the substantive union law. That's probably a fair guide in assessing this. Now, extremely important, the next step. You can no longer confuse, like it was often done in the literature, the substantive scope of application vis-à-vis the member states of the Charter of Fundamental Rights of the European Union in globo, the whole of the Charter, on the one hand, and Article 19 of the Treaty on European Union on the other hand. I'm referring here, of course, to the judgment of the Associação Sindical dos Juízes Portugueses, the Portuguese judges' case. And the Portuguese judges' case is a very neat illustration of the way in which the Court of Justice of the European Union operates. The case was, in a sense, without big importance as far as the actual substance of the case is concerned. You have the austerity measures decided by the then Portuguese government. One of the ministers of that government is in the room today. And this is a horizontal reduction of the highest salaries of the public sector in Portugal applicable to the legislator, to the judiciary, to the executive, to the ambassadors, to everyone, to the military, to everyone in Portugal. A number of judges, allow me now that the case is close to be slightly more direct in my wording, had a very bad taste to say, yes, but I mean, this can be so for everyone, that the highest salaries are temporarily reduced with 10% to 15% maximum. But for the judges, you know, that is indeed impinging upon our independence. Of course, the court in two short and rather straightforwardly worded paragraph says this has nothing to see with independence. This is not specifically targeted at the judges. This is a totally valid exercise of the public authority in a sense of social justice, and the judges have to contribute to that like anyone else. This has nothing to see with independence. So far, the unimportant part of the judgment. But before to get there, before you have our court, the Court of Justice of the European Union, capable of speaking out on the independence of a national court, that needed a whole development of constitutional import at EU level. And, of course, the main case was not substantively linked to union law within the meaning of Article 51.1 of the Charter. Why? Since the Pringle judgment, it had become clear and vested case law that a memorandum of understanding concluded between the ESM, represented by the European Commission and the European Central Bank on the one hand, and a Eurozone member state in need of financial assistance on the other hand, that this fell formally outside the European Union legal order, although in our later judgment we made it clear that the Commission and the European Central Bank as institutions are nevertheless bound by the Charter of Fundamental Rights of the European Union in their actions on behalf of the ESM. But that was here not a problem. Here it's the national measures which are in issues. And the national measures are not implementation of union law. That's the Pringle judgment. So the question was, what is the nexus to European Union law? The way in which the And the, I must say that the Tribunal Administrativo Supremo of Portugal helped us because they had mentioned next to Article 47 of the Charter, the fundamental right to effective judicial protection, also Article 19. And Article 19 of the Treaty on European Union contains the obligation for member states to provide for effective judicial protection in the fields covered by union law. And that's the way it's stated. Dans les domaines couverts par le droit de l'Union. And that in all the, dans les domaines couverts par le droit de l'Union, in the fields covered by union law, is of course something very different from only when they are implementing union law. And of course the court expressly plays on that, contrasts the two wordings and says, well, national courts are by their very essence union courts, because the whole decentralized paradigm of enforcement, of uniform application and enforcement of union law in preliminary reference dialogue with the Court of Justice in order to ensure equality of all member states and peoples before union law through the uniformity of interpretation, application and enforcement, it requires that the national courts be reliable, trustworthy as union courts. So our court ended up saying that the national courts are by their very nature union courts, and that therefore, to the extent it goes very far, to the extent that the national court is, in French they have a beautiful word, susceptible, that is, in its nature, in a position to apply and enforce union law, which, frankly speaking, all national courts satisfy that criterion. In their capacity of union courts, their independence and impartiality is part of union law review. So it's a very, very broad basis for the core value of the rule of law, understood in its core essence as the guarantee of independent and impartial courts operating according to fair trial rules. And where, of course, do we find the substantive content of that provision 19, there of course we take Article 47 of the Charter, not applicable as such, but as a provision informing the substantive content of the obligation to be fulfilled by the Member States under Article 19 of the Treaty on European Union. Once the Court has delivered that judgment, the European Commission had a kind of aha-erlebnis. They said, aha, that's the way to do it. There is, therefore, an alternative to the difficult way of Article 70 EU, at the very least to the extent that we speak about the enforcement of the rule of law. And effectively, the Commission started filing infringement actions against a particular member state after that judgment. And although the judgment concerned Portugal, Portuguese judges, the infringement actions concerned another member state whose first letters are equally PO. Now, that is how the case law in fact develops. You have always the interaction between our court saying something, the political process thereafter picking it up, and a third infringement action against the same member state has been now filed relating to the disciplinary proceedings against judges. That has been filed very recently, a few weeks ago it came in. And of course we also have further preliminary references, not only from that particular member state, but also from several other member states. But do not misunderstand me, and I insist on this here, publicly. This is not a matter of distinction between die bösen und die guten. It is not a distinction between the good and the evil. We all have to learn. So the judicial systems in all our member states should be placed under very, very close scrutiny. Member state judicial systems that do not operate in an efficient way, in a qualitative way, in a way triggering the trust of the litigants, they are extremely vulnerable to political hijacking of all sorts. And it's a responsibility of all of the member states. And our court is extremely even-handed. For instance, on the 27th of May 2019, very recent, 6 months ago, we handed down a preliminary reference on a request from the High Court of Justice in Dublin on the question to know whether the Staatsanwälte, the procureurs in Germany, could be an issuing judicial authority under the European Arrest Warrant Framework decision, because the High Court said those can receive individual instructions of the Justice Minister at either Länder- or Bundesebene, at the level of the Bund or the Länder, and therefore there is not this judicial independence which is normally required from a court, and there is no judicial review possible. There was a parallel case involving the General Procurator of Lithuania. Our court handed down a judgment common for the three situations. And we said a procureur can issue a European arrest warrant, but he or she needs to be fully independent, meaning that he or she may not be subject to possible instructions. Das Weisungsrecht in German. Possible instructions, one. And two, there must be judicial review possible against that decision by the lawyer, because the person concerned will, of course, by definition, be in another member state, by the lawyer concerned against that order. Those conditions were not fulfilled in the case of Germany. And in Germany, the law is already changed. So they immediately acted to change the law, to no longer make it possible that there be individual instructions and to provide for judicial review before the first instance court, meaning de facto that in case of contestation, it's the first instance court issuing the European arrest warrant, which is perfect. But the Lithuanian procureur fully satisfies. So, I mean, that's what I mean to say. It's an even-handed case law, because there the Lithuanian procureur can receive no instructions whatsoever and all his or her decisions are reviewable in court. So it shows you we work with neutral standards to uphold the rule of law. Second, this whole charter, has it led to a sort of uniformity of fundamental rights protection, thereby wiping out all diversity and possible more ambitious standards of protection of fundamental rights at national level? I think here there are several things. The crucial question here is whether the legislative process at EU level has decided on a particular level of protection of the fundamental rights involved, and sometimes it's even conflicting fundamental rights. It will be very often a trade-off, a balancing between conflicting fundamental rights. You have plenty of examples, like everyone knows, in the analysis. For instance, the right to be forgotten, our recent Google judgment, 24th of September 2019, must be balanced against the right of access to information. It's Article 7 and 8 of the Charter against Article 11 of the Charter. And then you have a balance in Article 17 of the GDPR, General Data Protection Regulation, to balance these two rights. And we give further explanations on the balancing of these rights. It is, of course, so that Article 17 of GDPR, as interpreted in these judgments, two related judgments of the Grand Chamber of our court on the 24th of September last, that this is a very intricate balance. So a member state would not say, yes, but I mean, that's all very well, but I protect the right to information so heavily and much more ambitiously that in fact the other right is totally undervalued. So there you see it's an example of where the balancing of rights is precisely struck in an intricate legislative process with the democratic legitimacy which it enjoys, the ordinary legislative procedure, previously called the co-decision procedure, between the qualified majority in the Council and the parliamentary majority in the European Parliament. There it is binary. either the choice made by the legislator is in conformity with the Charter, and then it must be uniformly applied and enforced, or it is not valid, and then, of course, it will have to be struck down. And, of course, you have examples of all of that, a matter where the balance was not appropriately struck by according to our court. It's the Digital Rights Ireland and Zeitlinger case, 2014, where the retention of all the metadata and the localization data for electronic communications was not upheld by our court because it was not appropriately balanced against the rights to protecting privacy. It was also in the background a matter of balancing general interest or the balancing even the right to security, which is also mentioned in Article 6 of the Charter, against the right to privacy and personal data, but the court held upon analysis that the balance had not been correctly struck and was really unbalanced and therefore invalid. So the homework needs to be done over again, and that process is still underway. But it's rather exceptional that you come to such a censure of the legislative balance struck. It's like in the national states, the member states, the constitutional courts will not more than strictly needed censure what the democratic legislature has done. But in a normal case, it will all hinge on the fact whether the union legislator has harmonized or not a particular issue. And I give you the example of the Meloni judgment, which has been handed down the same day than the already mentioned Åkerberg-Franzen, and it comes well in point for this part of the analysis. In Meloni, you have an Italian businessman who is convicted in the late 1990s of fraudulent bankruptcy. And he's convicted at first instance, confirmed on appeal, and his final appeal before the Corte Suprema di Cassazione is being dismissed. At all levels, he is represented by the lawyer, a major law firm of his trust, but he loses at all instances. Shortly before the final judgment, he moves, making use of the free movement, to Spain, where he starts a new life, and he is now living as an Italian in Spain, free movement of union citizens, no problem as such. 2002 comes the European Arrest Warrant Framework decision, and it is amended in 2009. It's amended on the following ground. The initial version of the framework decision provided for a judgment in absentia. Mr. Meloni had been personally absent from the trial at all stages, but was represented by a lawyer of his trust. He knew the place and the time of the proceedings, and he was represented by a lawyer of his trust. So initially, he could have claimed a new trial under the initial version of the framework decision. But in 2009, and listen carefully, that's a crucial point, the legislator found that this led to abuses of people knowingly and willingly not attending the proceedings, being represented there, and when they lose, they go to another member state. When they are caught there and surrender, they claim a new trial all from the beginning again upwards. So the member states unanimously, that was in the old system, the unanimity, it was the old third pillar, decide to amend, and they say when the convicted person, convicted in absentia, knew the time and the place of the proceedings, as well as was represented by a lawyer, cumulative conditions of his or her trust, then it must be irrebuttably presumed that the person knowingly and willingly has not been personally present at the trial, gave up its right to be personally present at a trial. So, in Spain, in the Constitution, there is an Article 20 saying that for extradition cases, when you have been convicted in absentia, whatever the conditions, you can be extradited, but only under condition that you get a new trial. So the Spanish Constitutional Court asks, what should I do? All the normal courts, first instance appeal Tribunal Supremo had ordered the surrender of Mr. Meloni to Italy to purge his prison sentence. Recurso de Amparo before the Constitutional Court, and they ask our Constitution. It protects the man better because it provides for a new trial, but it bumps frontally into the amended version of the framework decision. Our court has said that the amended version of the framework decision fully complies with the Charter of Fundamental Rights, and this while drawing on extensive Strasbourg case law, European Convention on Human Rights, on common constitutional traditions of the member states, which consider as a full respect for the rights of defence and presumption of innocence when you have been represented by a lawyer of your trust at all stages of the proceedings. And that is sufficient. Therefore, we said to the Spanish court, you cannot, by way of so-called protecting better as a standard of national law, in a way refuse the mutual trust, which is the backbone of the system of surrender. And the system of surrender is important because, of course, without it, there is a high risk of impunity. If that person is not surrendered or is surrendered, I mean, there might be a problem also of prescription time, etc. So it's also a matter of big complexity which the legislator has assessed. So in that case, no room for diversity. That is solely because there was a very precise legislative decision which was in conformity with the Charter. However, and there are many more examples of that. We had the example on non-discrimination on grounds of age, of religion, recent cases, many cases where the European standard is the standard for mutual recognition. Totally different was the case known as the Tarico saga in Italy. That is a case where the value-added tax fraud cases, they are prosecuted before criminal courts. Prosecuted before criminal courts. But of course, the proceedings before criminal courts, and especially the statute of limitations, the prescription time, is not regulated at all. It will now change because the directive has been adopted and it's now in the period of transposition. But when the facts of the case played, no substantive EU law rules there. There our court had no difficulty saying, in the absence of clear rules of EU law, that is a choice made by the Union legislator, the Charter of Fundamental Rights does not say anything relevant here. Every member state must be able to apply its own constitutional standards. The Charter of Fundamental Rights surely said that the so-called legality principle, nulla poena sine lege, nullum crimen sine lege, nulla poena sine lege, but that is of course very general. In Italy, they consider the prescription time as falling under that principle, which is the case in a minority of member states, not in most member states. In most member states, the prescription time is a procedural matter having nothing to see with the legality of the crime and of the sanction. But in Italy, they say, ah, no, because once the statute of limitations has run out, you simply can no longer be prosecuted. You're off the hook, right? You can no longer have a sanction. Of course that is part of the nulla poena sine lege. The law is no longer allowed to punish you. So, yeah, it's a view which you can also defend, frankly speaking. So the member states were very far apart in terms of bringing the statute of limitations under the legality principle in criminal law, or not bringing it under it and considering it as a mere ancillary procedural question. So we said, well, here member states can make their own choice and apply their more protective rules because union law has not provided anything. And therefore, the Charter as such was not really triggered in deciding what Italy could do or not. We added, of course, that the legislator, by the way, was under an obligation to reform the justice system of Italy to such an extent as making it capable, within the time limit set, to combat effectively the VAT fraud, because that is a rule of union law. The VAT directive says that in case of fraud, there must be effective, proportionate and dissuasive sanctions, and that, if you want, was of course the rule of union law that everyone should comply with. Finally, the possible horizontal application of charter provisions. That is, of course, also a very, very big issue. The argument has been made by Advocate General Tarsenjak here in the room that the horizontal, in the Dominguez opinion, that the horizontal application of the Charter was not really, as a matter of principle, to be defendable, because Article 51.1, of which we already spoke, that is, the Charter is applicable to the institutions and bodies of the Union, and then to the Member States only when they are implementing Union law. So it is true that at first sight, the Charter does not really put any obligation on a private party whatsoever. And the Court has therefore been extremely cautious in opening nevertheless the gate, and you will see it is still a very narrow gate, but it's not totally closed. So against the backdrop of this absence of a mention of private parties in Article 51, first paragraph, rightly mentioned by Advocate General Tersniak, the Court in a way focused more on the substantive fundamental right in issue. For instance, the first example where a horizontal application was nevertheless accepted even from before the Charter as such was in operation is Article 21. It's the famous non-discrimination article, because since the case De Frenne against Sabina, 1976, the Court accepts that between employers and employees, the principle of equal pay for equal work or work of equal value between women and men can be invoked between private parties, a private employer and a private employee. And that's quite obvious, because you empty such rights almost entirely of their effectiveness if you're not allowing that right to come into play directly between all employers, wherever they be, public or private, on the one hand, and the employees on the other hand. And the Court there was in good company, because the constitutional traditions common to the member states, if they have accepted a so-called drittverkung, that is an operation as between private parties of a fundamental right, it always starts with all kinds of shades and variants of the non-discrimination principle. And so our Court has extended that principle in recent cases like Egenberger and IR. IR is a particularly important case. It's a chief medical doctor who is the head of a medical service in a Catholic hospital in Germany, and he is being fired because he divorced and remarried, what in a certain understanding of Catholic morals, ethics, is against the rules of the Church. And they fired him. But Mr. IR said, yes, but I mean, in the same hospital, there are Protestant doctors, and there are also confessionsloze, these doctors who publicly are without any religion, and they can divorce and marry as many times they want, and they're not disturbed in their employment relationship. So he said, I am discriminated on the basis of religion. And long story short, our court applying Article 21 of the Charter, as further fleshed out by Directive 2000/78, said, yes, that is absolutely so. You are being discriminated, and you can, of course, invoke that right as against that private hospital, because it's the non-discrimination right. It is fundamental that it can work in the relations between all employers and employees. We said the same of Article 47 of the Charter, that is this already mentioned right to effective judicial protection. But in a way, that right is a sort of ancillary right of another main right, meaning that if you can invoke union law directly, let's say a provision of a regulation like GDPR, it's private persons against Google, but it's a regulation now, so it's totally invocable. Everyone agrees with that since ever, that a regulation can be invoked in litigation as within private parties. Yeah, quite obviously, the right to effective judicial protection of Article 47 of the Charter must, par la nature de la chose, also be horizontally operational. So that right as well, and we said it openly in the Schrems Facebook case of 2015, has a horizontal application. But more recently, we have, and that comes closer to the Dominguez case, in the cases Bauer und Wilmeroth und Max Planck's Gesellschaft, we have also held that the core essence, and notice the word essence, the essence of the fundamental right to annual leave protected in Article 31, second paragraph of the Charter, is also invocable as between a private employer and his or her employees. And the court was very cautious. It says the essence of the right, that is, the rights which you acquire are protected as such. And of course, then the question is, what is the essence and what is not the essence? And you all know, specialists as you are of fundamental rights thinking, when you trigger the notion of the essence of a fundamental right, it's like pushing a button. You in fact say that essence can no longer be constrained by any limitation. It's the core essence, after all. If you read Article 52 this time, first paragraph, it says the essence of the rights can never be breached or touched under whatever reason, the rights of others or the public interest or whatever. It becomes an unabdingbares grondrecht, as they say in the German Staatslehre. So the court has there said, well, this essence of the right is protected also in private relations. And the court explains why that is so. To conclude, I hope to have made sure, to have made clear that the Charter of Fundamental Rights comes in, and I've made a severe selection of cases, all Grand Chamber cases, and there are many more also mentioned in my written version of this presentation, and many more in existence when you search in our database, the judicial network of the European Union, which is now publicly accessible over the website of the court, you will see many more examples. It is really, as I said at the beginning, in these two functions, an aid, a guide to interpretation of all other types of rules of union law. Plenty of these examples express that. That's the first function. And second, as a standard for judicial review of acts of union law which are said to be in conflict with the Charter. That is the classical constitutionality review. For the comparative lawyers, it's Marbury versus Madison in the US case law. It is really the review of the legislation of the Union against the standards of the Bill of Rights being the Charter of Fundamental Rights of the Union. But all of this being contained in the applicability provision of the Charter, Article 51.1. However, for important that article is, it is not the final word about the enforceability in the Court of Justice of the European Union of the values on which the Union is founded. And they're not just the rule of law. I quote them in order: human dignity, freedom, democracy, and believe me, there is no such a thing as illiberal democracy. That is not democracy. Democracy is a liberal democracy or it is not. Respect for the rule of law, fundamental rights, in a society characterized by pluralism, tolerance, equality, in particular equality between women and men, and solidarity. Those values can be upheld by our court even when the threshold of Article 51(1) of the Charter is not reached, whenever you can combine the value of Article 2 with a substantive provision or rule of union law, which in the Juízes Portugueses case was Article 19, the obligation of the member states to provide for effective judicial protection in the fields covered by union law. But there are other cases pending where you have the freedom of establishment. Think about the establishment of agricultural undertakings in the case Commission against Hungary, which is already decided on the usufruct, where the right to property was combined with the right of establishment. Or cases on the Central European University, now pending in the Grand Chamber of our court, or on the financing of NGOs, where you have a combination of the values, sometimes with specifics in the Charter, but always with substantive rules of union law. It is the central role of our court to very practically and in case of litigation to ensure that the law is always upheld, not just the nitty-gritty techniques of substantive law, that is important enough, but beyond that, and I would almost say underneath, underpinning that substantive law, the values and the fundamental rights on which the sustainability of the European Union as a common governance structure and a common legal space is being built. Thank you very much. Mm-hmm.